Philippine Senator Jinggoy Estrada becomes the latest politician to be acquitted in his plunder case in the pork barrel scam. But the Philippine Anti-Graft Court found him guilty of bribery. Let's get more details from ABS-CBN's Victoria Tulad. Victoria, what more can you tell us?
Carmina, not guilty. This was the ruling handed down by the Sandigan Bayan 5th Division on Senator Jinggoy Estrada's plunder case in connection with the alleged misuse of his Priority Development Assistance Fund, or PDAF. He is, however, guilty of one count of direct bribery penalized under the revised penal code and is thus sentenced to a minimum of 8 years up to a maximum of 9 years and 4 months of imprisonment. This has the accessory penalty of temporary absolute disqualification and perpetual special disqualification from the right of suffrage. Estrada is also ordered to pay a fine of 3 million pesos. The lawmaker is also guilty of two counts of indirect bribery and is sentenced to 2 years and 4 months, up to 3 years, 6 months and 20 days, with penalties of suspension and public censure, suspension from public office and from the right to follow a profession or calling, and perpetual special disqualification from the right to suffrage. Estrada's case stems from the charge of him diverting his PDAF to bogus non-government organizations of Pork Barrel Queen Janet Limnapoles and pocketing kickbacks of 183 million pesos. Napoles, according to the Anti-Graft Court, is also not guilty of plunder, but she is guilty of 5 counts of corrupting public officials, which has a sentence of 8 years to 10 years and 8 months imprisonment. She needs to pay a fine of more than 29.6 million pesos. Napoles is also guilty beyond reasonable doubt of 2 counts of corruption of public officials, which has a sentence of 2 years and 4 months to 4 years, 9 months and 10 days. She again needs to pay a fine, this time amounting to more than 262 million pesos with 6% annual interest. Napoles was not present in the hearing. The other co-accused in Estrada's case, his former Deputy Chief of Staff, Pauline Therese Mary Labayan, and John Raymond de Asis, Napoles' driver and messenger, who was designated as president of one of her NGOs, were issued an alias warrant of arrest since they continue to remain at large. According to the decision, Labayan primarily benefited from Estrada's PDAF and transactions with Napoles. Despite the convictions, attorney Alexis Abastilla Suarez, Estrada's lawyer, still considers the ruling as a win because the lawmaker was exonerated for plunder. Plunder, according to Republic Act 7080, or an act defining and penalizing the crime of plunder, is the accumulation of a public official of ill-gotten wealth amounting to at least 50 million pesos through various criminal acts. According to Abastilla Suarez, they were surprised about the inclusion of bribery charges and will still have to read through the 396-page decision. Because the ruling is not yet final, Estrada's camp has two options: to file a motion for reconsideration before the Sandigan Bayan or file an appeal at the Supreme Court. This is why he can still hold public office.
I did not steal any money. I did not receive any money. That's why I would like to thank the magistrates of the Sandigan Bayan that after 1 decade, my case has already been resolved. This is a vindication of my name, and I am emerging victorious at this point. But as to the conviction of the direct and indirect bribery, I am not a lawyer. I haven't read the decision, but I am so surprised since, based on the information sheet, there was no bribery or indirect or direct bribery filed in the information sheet. It is only the case of plunder. Okay. And I have been already acquitted. I have been exonerated of plunder. And I will ask my lawyers to exhaust all legal remedies, all legal options available for me. But then still, I believe in our justice system.
Since Estrada already has a bail bond and travel bond for plunder, the court will just use this as his bond for his bribery convictions, which is also why he does not need to be detained. Estrada is also facing 11 graft charges before the 5th Division. Carmina?
Yes, Victoria. Any more on the conviction of the senator on direct and indirect bribery? Who did the senator bribe?
Carmina, we still have to read through the 396-page decision. We asked the lawyers on what the basis of the direct and indirect bribery could be, but they are also still at a loss because they haven't read the decision, and they said that they will give us feedback after they do so.
All right, we're going to have to leave it at that. Victoria Tula there joining us live. Thanks again. Estrada's colleagues at the Senate weighing in on the Sandigan Bayan's ruling on his pork barrel scam case. Senate President Juan Miguel Zubiri says Senator Estrada has the right to exhaust all legal means. Zubiri adds, until the court's decision is final and executory, Estrada is duty-bound to serve in the upper chamber. Meanwhile, Senator Estrada's half-brother, Senator J.V. Ejercito, urges everyone to respect the wisdom of the country's justice system. A leading advocate of a people's initiative to amend the Philippine Constitution expects it to culminate in a plebiscite by July. RJ Cruz reports.
House Ways and Means Committee Chair Joey Salceda, an advocate of charter change, believes the people's initiative to amend the charter will meet the required 12% of signatures of voters nationwide next week, and that it's on track for ratification by July, confirming a timeline previously exposed by Kabataan party list.
I think most of the country, I think by next week, we must have already achieved the 12%, beyond the 12% of nationals. It's a question of physically submitting it to the local COMELEC region. We are in that process already. Pervasively, I think 80% of the country is already in that process.
The timeline details the milestones from the gathering of signatures, vetting by the Commission on Elections, all the way to the plebiscite. Salceda is unbothered by the 20 districts where there is difficulty in getting the signatures of the 3%, since there are 60 districts where more than 3% have been gathered. Advocates are careful, though, since missing even just one district will kill the initiative.
The PI is already inevitable. I heard that Marco Wangco is trying to beat 50%. Mian Singson has beaten 30%. There is an attempt to, go beyond, to make up for the slow-moving.
Albay First District Representative Edsel Lagman, however, maintains the signature-gathering process is flawed, arguing that verified voters should sign the petition in front of an election register. He hopes the COMELEC will issue the necessary clarification. Salceda believes the House will insist on their version of the amendments to the economic provisions of the Charter, which they approved in the 18th Congress, claiming it has a bigger and better impact on the economy as it amends 7 provisions compared to the 3 sectors in the Senate proposal. Salceda explains the Senate proposal only affects public utilities, education, and advertising, but the House also wants changes to natural resources, land, and mass media ownership.
Yung in-open nila, maabot lang ng 2%. Yung inopen ng House, 14% of the entire GDP. So 3.11% versus 14, 15%. So 5 times. So bakit, why go for 3 times? Magbubukas ka na lang, edi buksan mo na lahat.
Meanwhile, Salceda foresees a problem if the House and the Senate cannot agree on the amendments. He doubts a bicameral conference committee can be convened in a charter amendment. He hopes deliberations will instead be joint, even if voting is separate.
I cannot foresee a kind of reconciliation through a bicameral conference committee, because that is not provided for as one of the processes of Congress acting as a constituent assembly.
The House's resolution of both houses number 2 in the 18th Congress is among the 358 attempts by lawmakers to change the Constitution since the 18th Congress. RG Cruz, ABS-CBN News.
Senator Risa Ontiveros hits efforts for a people's initiative for charter change. Ontiveros says the signature campaign cannot even be considered a people's initiative, with the public kept in the dark on who is leading that effort. She also believes there's a political push behind it.
How cynical is that? No, a way to propel a so-called people's initiative kung yung vote buying nga na pinoproblema natin tuwing election ay ginagawa di umano pati sa ganitong political exercise in between elections. Kung pagbabatayan natin yung reaction ng mga kababayan natin, just for example on social media, when this people's initiative came out, I don't think anyone should be overconfident na sure win na yung people's initiative nila.
Ontiveros adds she's not open to any changes in the Constitution right now.
Even now, the resolution of both houses filed in the Senate, with all due respect to my colleagues, in the first place, hindi kailangan na lalong paluwagin, i-liberalize yung economic provisions ng Constitution We have, in fact, Congress has in fact been doing that already through legislation. Palakasin din natin yung kumpiyansa ng mga foreign investors sa business environment dito. At isa na doon is to reduce the instability, which ironically for the Chacha advocates, Chacha itself instigates.
The word war between the Philippines and China intensifies. Beijing's foreign ministry again accuses the Philippines of violating the so-called One China policy, insisting it will never accept any provocations on the Taiwan issue. This comes after Manila's top defense official Gilbert Teodoro criticized China for engaging in what he described as gutter talk. Tensions between the two countries entered a new front after President Marcos congratulated Lai Ching-te, the president-elect in the self-ruled island, which China claims as its own.
China principle is the red line and bottom line. China will never accept anyone's provocations on the Taiwan issue and will resolutely fight back. We urge the Philippine side to earnestly abide by the spirit of the China-Philippines joint communique and abide by the One China principle and stop its wrong words and deeds on the Taiwan issue.
The remarks from Beijing's foreign ministry did not sit well with Philippine Senator Rizzo Ontiveros. Ontiveros believes the Marcos administration should review the One China policy.
Wala kayong K na manduhan kami how we are or are not to speak and act about our own national interest in these waters. Mm-hmm. So it's important for us to keep trying to put the giant in our neighborhood in her place. And sana lumakas ang loob natin lalo dahil, well, China probably thinks we are the weak link in the region. Kaya she doesn't speak to us or to our leaders the same way she would speak, say, to the Singaporean. I-review na rin kaya nila yung ating foreign policy vis-a-vis the People's Republic of China. I-review yung One China policy.